freedom of religion in this country, which I have to take off my hat to, which is second to none in the world, freedom of religion. In this country, freedom of religion to preach. You see, freedom of religion, as a young man, I was reading the communist constitution. And so article so-and-so tells us, and I read it, and that there is freedom of religious practices and anti-religious propaganda. I'm quoting. Mm-hmm. Freedom of religious practices and anti-religious propaganda. So I thought, well, look, we both have a fair chance. Mm-hmm. But I didn't understand that he says freedom of religious practices. That freedom is given to you, but not to preach. And anti-religious propaganda. Well, the 4,000 Muslims are going to the mosque for prayer. The guy outside can make a noise and say, hey, there's fools there, look what they're doing. You see how they pray. They can make a mockery of it. But I can't come out and say, hey, look, man, come inside and I will tell you, you know, how to get peace. But the system that
we
are following...
It's a one-sided deal.
It's one-sided. Mm-hmm. But in South Africa, when they say there's freedom of religion, they do really give it to us. In other words, I go to the City Hall of Cape Town, which I did go to, and I organize a lecture there, Christianity, Communism or Islam, which has the answer to the problems of South Africa. And this City Hall of Cape Town is a stone's throw from Parliament House mm-hmm. in Cape Town. Mm-hmm. And I delivered a lecture to a packed audience there. Christianity, Communism or Islam. And since the speaker is a Muslim, it's understood automatically that it is not Christianity, it is not communism, Islam is the answer.
Yes.
Right. And no interference from the government on any level, no interference. Then we had a conflict with the government twice we had a conflict with the government on our publications. One was in 1982, I published a pamphlet, The Crimes of Begin. You know,
yes,
after Sabra and Shatila
Menachem
massacre.
Begin.
Right. Menachem Begin, his crimes, the crimes of Begin. And that pamphlet, the Jews had it brought up before the publications board. Mm-hmm. And they had it banned. We made representation, but our representation, I mean, I blame my soldier, you know, my lawyer. I lost the case. Then the government, the Christians now this time, they took up another of my publication called Crucifixion or Crucifixion. It sounds the same. Like a riddle, it's not. Crucifixion, the first is F-I-X-I-O-N, fiction, to fix a man on the cross and kill. And the other fiction is F-I-C-T-I-O-N, fiction means a fairy tale. Mm-hmm. Is it a fiction to fix and kill, or is it a fiction, a fairy tale? Mm-hmm. That's the title of my book. And some missionaries, they brought it to the attention of the director of publication. The director of publication read it, and he directed his board in Pretoria. He is in Cape Town, he directs his board in Pretoria, he says, ban the book. The board goes through the book and they say, look, this is not very pleasant. We don't like this book. It's a very important book undermining our foundation of our faith, which is the crucifixion. Death and resurrection of Christ is the foundation, and this book undermines that. It's a very dangerous book. But it does not infringe any law, so we can't ban it. So the director of publication went on appeal against his own board. You know, this is something unique. To me, it's a unique thing. In any country in the world, the director say, ban, the thing is banned. You can go and fight it out afterwards. But this, the director goes on appeal against his own board. In that case, he's going to hire an advocate to represent him against the board, to convince them that the book should be banned. So for the first time, the board informs us that, look, this is what has transpired so far. If you want to defend your book, you come along and defend it yourself. We will not play the devil's advocate on your behalf. So we went and defended our book, and we won the case against the government. So to me, there is that freedom. If you can play the game according to the rules of the game, there is nothing for you to worry about.
Now, this is a very good entrance, what you have just described, that you held the crucifixion
yes.
up, and you made your case, which
right.
I believe when I read something about that, that Jesus appeared, you believe, as dressed as the gardener, when it said that
the
ladies thought he was
He's
the gardener. It's
him
because
to the gardener.
He was not, yes.
Right.
And it goes on like that. You have said that in the name of freedom of speech,
right.
even though that was an abomination
right.
unto Christians,
right.
they allowed you and you won your case.
Right.
May I move now to Rushdie
right.
and the fact that he has printed something which I assume, I have never read it and I don't intend to, is equally as, quotes, insulting to the Islamic religion as that would be to the Christian.
Right.
And yet he is under penalty of death.
Right.
And you are not under penalty of death.
No.
No, for having said this.
Right.
Could you lead us into this discussion using those two cases?
Yes. You see, now, in the case, the government says, in my case, about my book, that this is a bona fide belief. I'm not trying to make a mockery of the Christian. See, just I want to be funny, I want to be clever. They say, hey, look, this is nonsense, man. How can one man, you know, take the sins of the world? You know, this is taking you, the Christianity is taking 1,000 million people for a ride on a cross.
Yeah, I believe it.
Right, no, right. But now that I'm making a mockery. In there's a law in the country, you are not to sneer at somebody else's religion. Mm-hmm. What I was telling was a bona fide belief, because my book says, وَمَا كَتَلُوهُ وَمَا صَلَبُهُ, which means they didn't kill him and they didn't crucify him. My book says that. This is my belief, a bona fide belief. So as such now, I'm expounding it. If it goes against you in that case, I just can't help it. This is the belief that's given to me by my faith, and 1,000 million people believe in it. In the case of Rushdie, it is not that. See, he has gone out of his way to abuse everybody. Like, for example, in South Africa, we had the book banned, just like that. See, there's a law. The law is there, and according to that law, we succeeded. You are not to sneer at somebody else's belief. Right? This guy here, the races. You know, our biggest problem is race, as I said in my previous interview. Everywhere is a race. This man is the greatest racist. You know, he beats Hitler's Mein Kampf. We show to the director, look what this guy says. He says, nigger, eat white man's shit. Is it right, sir? The guy says, no. This is rank racism. He's a racist himself, but this is rank racism. Then he says, black shit is bad. He calls them niggers, he calls them coons, he calls them what and what not. Right? So they said, no, ban the book. Ban the book. This is not right. Then he's used certain type of language. One word.
Which we don't have to use.
No. For one word, Lady Chatterley's lover was banned in this country for 20 years. Mm-hmm. That word he uses 55 to 57 times in his book, forgetting that he's besmirching the characters of the Islamic faith, you know, our spiritual mothers, the wives of the prophet himself, then the prophet Abraham and the companions of the prophet, the thing that he calls them, this, which makes anybody's blood boil, especially the Muslim. But besides that, what he has done to everybody, the white man, the white woman, the Jews, he has not spared anybody. But the problem with the people outside, in the Western countries, nobody brought this to the attention of the people there. We only cried about ourselves. We said, look, he swore my mother. Who? It's Aisha Siddiqa, wife of the Prophet. Where is she? No, she can sue him. I said, no, she's dead. So how long? 1400 years. Says, does it hurt her? The guy's making a mockery of it. See, it's a mockery now. This does it hurt her? Now you're making a mockery of it. But now if I turn the tables, it would be different. I said, you know, sir, I told the people in Britain, I went around on a lecture tour. I'm telling them, I says, you know what he says about Mrs. Margaret Thatcher? So what does he say? So I said, he calls her torture, full stop, one word sentence, torture. Then he says, Maggie the bitch, three word sentence, Maggie the bitch. I said, is it right? I said, you people should have gone to Mrs. Thatcher and says, Ma, with an open book, the satanic verses, says, Ma, look, this fellow is calling you a bitch. Is it right, Ma? But maybe you can take it. You know, you are great. You are the Iron Lady. You know, to you is nothing. But what about the feeling? The feelings of your dear son, Mark, somebody calling him son of a bitch. What about his feelings? What about your daughter, Carol? What about her feelings? Shh, the book would have been banned. You know what he does with the queen? He cohabits with her in the book. He makes tender love to her and he joins with her.
But, Mr. Deedat, if I may say so,
yes.
You see, as a Christian,
right.